We're gonna have fun with this video. This is one of only two fully functional M48 AVLBs in private hands that we know of. In this video, we're gonna deploy the bridge, we're gonna drive vehicles across it, we're gonna pick up the bridge, we're gonna disappear. We're just gonna have lots of fun. AVLB stands for Armored Vehicle Launch Bridge. So what we really have is just a mobile bridge. This bridge can go anywhere a tank can go. It also gives us tremendous tactical flexibility. We don't have to use existing crossings. We can create our own. The enemy can't just wait at an existing bridge for us to come down the road. We might cross anywhere over a water obstacle or over certain land obstacles. The AVLB system has three major components. The first is the transporting launcher. I might also refer to it as a chassis or as a hull. The second major component is the launching system that you see placed on top of the hull, including the carrying rack toward the back. The third component, obviously, is the bridge. Let's dig into the details of the transporting launcher. According to Honeycutt, the United States started on its first AVLB design in 1949, working with a variety of different bridge concepts and the chassis of an M46 Patton tank. By the time the Army Ordnance Department settled on a hydraulically launched scissors bridge or folding bridge, the standard production tank was the M48A2. So that then became the basis for the transporting launcher. What we have here started out as either an M48A2 or an M48A2C conventional Patton tank. To transform it into a transporting launcher was a multi-step process. The first step was to take the turret off altogether, plate over the space inside the turret ring, build a two-person crew housing inside that turret ring, each crew position with its own cupola and hatch. The hydraulic launching equipment then was added to the top of the hull. Finally, on top of that was the bridge itself. Now, this is a folding aluminum bridge, a Class 60 bridge or military load Class 60 bridge. This bridge is capable of bearing the weight of an M48 Patton series of tanks or an M60 series of tanks. It's not strong enough for an Abrams tank. An Abrams tank would require a Class 70 bridge. The distinguishing feature of an M48A2 series tank is the number of return rollers. The M48A2 and then its subsequent improvement designated M48A2C are the only M48 series variants that have only three return rollers instead of five. The original M48 and the subsequent M48A1 both had five return rollers. Field experience, however, showed that the suspension system used for the M48, the same suspension system used for the M48A1, actually were prone to failure, particularly in cross-country use. So to make improvements to improve the robustness of the original suspension system, in the M48A2, designers removed two of the five return rollers, creating space for additional components that made the entire suspension system more robust. So we know that we have here a M48 series transporting launcher that started life either as an M48A2 or as an M48A2C. The only difference between the M48A2 and the subsequent C designation is a few additional improvements, none of which have any bearing on the use of this as a transporting launcher. Let me say a little bit more about this bridge. The bridge itself is 60 feet long. It has a usable span of 60 feet, just a little bit more than 18 meters. This entire system with the bridge and the transporting launcher, all of the launching equipment, weighed about 63 tons or 63,000 kilos. Now that's about 13 tons or 13,000 kilos more than the weight of a conventional battle tank. So that extra weight being carried on this chassis helps explain why the Army Ordnance Department selected the M48A2 and M48A2C variant of Patton tank. That stronger suspension system was better able to tolerate this 13 tons of additional weight. Enough about the details of the vehicle itself. Let's get this into operation.
Driving the M48 AVLB isn't like driving any of the other tanks that we have around here. It's got a lot of extra weight on top, around 30,000 pounds, and a lot of that's hanging off the back, and so it doesn't operate quite like the others. You have to kind of bounce it around the turns.
So once we start deploying the bridge, you bring the overhead cylinder up first. Once you get the bridge standing straight up, it's pretty intimidating with that thing standing 30 feet over your head. The incline that we deployed the bridge on doesn't look that steep on camera, but from inside the tank, it feels pretty steep. We were actually just about at the limits of what it could do. And that's where I rely on Dusty to look the situation over and make sure everything is safe.
All stop, we have contact with the hull. A little further, it's about 30 degrees right there, guy.
He keeps me about 4 to 10 feet off the ground when we're scissoring out.
One all stop on the swing, of course, scissoring. Roger that.
There's two cylinders that lay the bridge out. You start with your swing cylinder until you run out of extension on it, and then you switch to the tongue cylinder and alternate that between tongue and scissor. When you're alternating between the swing cylinder and the scissors, or the tongue and the scissors, the scissor cylinder is what is unfolding the bridge, and the swing and tongue are laying it out. Now, with the older valve block that is in this unit, you can't run two cylinders at the same time. You can only run one at a time, which doesn't keep it as smooth as it would be with some of the newer cylinder blocks where you could actuate two at a time.
Three, two, come down another foot.
When we're considering the location as to where we want to deploy the bridge, a couple things we're going to look for is whether or not we have a nice flat and level spot for the bridge to sit on.
This will be your final extension.
It's important for that to be flat and level because we go to line up the center pins to lock the bridge. If there's any twist in the bridge, sometimes that becomes very difficult to put those pins in, and we can kind of manipulate it with the hydraulics. If it's not sitting real flat and level, that can become a real challenge. So thankfully, when we laid the bridge, the pins just went right in, so it worked out really well.
Two. They're just about on the ground. Keep extending. All stop on the extension. Okay, so what they're going to do right now is we're going to pin the bridge so that when we you were to drive vehicles over it, it doesn't flex the bridge and damage it. A little more. Okay. Pins in. Roger that. All four pins are in. So what we're doing right now is we're relaxing the pressure on the hydraulics, so that we can then disconnect from the bridge. Okay, I'm looking at the pins right now. Go ahead and disengage.
Disengaging.
So what there's two lock pins that will have retracted so that we can unlock from the bridge.
So right now we're making sure that when you back out of the bridge that you're not going to snag on any part of it, and we don't damage anything on the launcher or the bridge itself. When we disconnect from the bridge, there's a couple of pins that we disengage hydraulically, and then one thing that you might notice here is that the hydraulic lines that go to the scissor cylinder, those disconnect automatically as we back the launcher away from the bridge. One of the cool things about this vehicle is that once it lays the bridge, it can drive itself over the bridge, turn around, and then retrieve it from the other side. So you can pick this up and deploy it from either end of the bridge.
About 4 inches.
The first time that we deployed the bridge, when we got it stood straight up, we had a hose break and the bridge came crashing to the ground. Luckily, it fell away from the tank and not back on it. For that reason, I usually keep my head down. Unfortunately, we didn't have video of that day. Nobody thought to be recording. It was quite violent inside the tank, and the guys on the outside watching said it was pretty impressive. The front end came off the ground about 4 feet, and then it rocked the back end up about 3 feet.
A little bit further, another 6 feet, all stop right there.
Now we're gonna have some fun. The head of our security team, Jack, and I are gonna wave across a variety of our military vehicles for your viewing pleasure. Thank you.
So recoupling the bridge, as you can imagine, is a little bit difficult. This thing's not exactly a surgical instrument, and you've only got a few inches to play with. So when I come in to recouple, the spotter's roll is very important to help me get in the right position so that the pins will line up with the holes, because I can't see anything that's going on.
Okay, I'll stop.
So once we're coupled back up to the bridge, retrieving it is a little bit different than deploying it. Instead of that weight falling away from you, it's coming back to you and you have a little bit more control over it.
Okay, stop there.
So you notice in the deployment this time, deploying it went really well. When we went to retrieve it, we had some trouble because it was laying off downhill to the right-hand side. The front two pins didn't want to go in. Once we got those in, then the pinnels didn't want to line up, and it took us a while to get those in. And then when we went to pick it up, I think we were maybe a little too steep an angle, and it didn't quite want to pick the bridge. So we ended up having to drag the bridge in the scissor action across the ground a little bit until we got it back to an angle that it could tolerate.
I got a couple more feet to go. 3, 2, 1, and you're on the cradle. Nice work, guy. Okay, you keep clear. You're clear. Keep backing up.
So after it was all said and done, we got it back up to flat level ground. We redeployed the bridge and inspected to make sure everything was all right. And then we decided it would probably be best if we applied a load to it to make sure that all operating systems were fine. And they were. Everything worked just fine.
There it goes, off to its next crossing. We'd love your feedback. Please keep it coming. And if you like our videos and haven't subscribed, please subscribe. Until next time.